afternoon, everybody, and welcome to Freedom on Deck on 94.9 News Now and Stimulating Talk. I'm me, Chet Martin, joined as always by the Long Island redneck, Brian Bro.
Oh, yeah, baby. Let's do it.
And, of course, the fearless C.V. Burton.
At your service.
You know, guys, it's a catastrophe and has been what's going on in North Carolina, as we know. I have family over there, and how dare President Trump send that hurricane into North Carolina like he did with his hurricane-making machine.
Really? Unpresidential.
Has the media lost their minds?
Oh, yeah. Have.
You think?
Have. When did they have a mind?
Well, the liberals keep saying that it's all on par. It's par for the course.
Oh, yeah.
And then the guy that made the Washington Post op-ed, which was criticizing Trump for this hurricane, said, well, he didn't create it, but his policies for the environment are helping
create
a bigger hurricane, which is going into North Carolina.
Yes, exactly. The less than 2 years that he's been in office has caused all of global warming, all of it, and has brought us to this point because Harvey and Katrina and the many, many, many other hurricanes that have been more powerful, more destructive than this one that were under the administration of Barack Obama.
Yeah.
You know, those must have been flukes. Those were accidents.
Well, CV, I don't know how bad the hurricane was anyway. We know it was bad, but we saw the one individual on the Weather Channel fighting to stand up as the hurricane came through on the Outer Banks, and two gentlemen behind him seemed to be A-okay.
They were giants.
Walking by.
They were giants.
I don't know. There was no collusion, apparently, that Trump colluded with Russia, but the hurricane is absolute proof that he colluded with the sun.
Yeah. Well, anyway, it goes to show you, no matter whether it's the weather, whether it's the news, whether it's Trump, whether it's the GOP, the media fakes everything. You can't trust them no matter what. But listen, newly released text messages showing anti-Trump FBI officials Peter Strzok and Lisa Page, sorry we have to talk about this again, discussing a media leak strategy amid the Russia probe, rekindled harsh criticism from President Trump and the Justice Department and FBI leadership, even as Strzok's attorney claimed that the text merely referred to efforts to stop leaks, which is absolute bull. When I was watching Hannity, he had Sarah Carter on, and she was talking about these leaks as soon as they came out. And what it was it was Strzok and Page talking about the fact that the FBI and the DOJ were colluding with the media in order to release this dossier, the Steele dossier that Hillary Clinton paid for, knowingly leaking this to the media. When are we going to get justice for this, with this kind of stuff coming out, knowing what the media is doing here?
Never.
They're like circle jerks. It's like they leak fake information from the fake dossier to the media. The media reports it, and then they put that the media's reports into another file to get more FISA warrants to spy on Trump.
Right.
So it's like a big circle jerk thing.
I just think that until Trump tosses out whoever he needs to in the FBI, in the CIA, I think that it's going to continue. You know, I remember early on when he was critical of the intelligence community?
Sure.
I mean, the awkward moment when him and Comey shook hands after he became president. You remember that?
Yeah, that was quite awkward.
Very awkward. You kind of knew right then and there what he was up against as far as it goes with the FBI and the CIA.
Yeah.
I just think that if he doesn't do something soon, whatever it is, whether it's firing Jeff Sessions and getting somebody in there that actually has the cojones to bring charges against people like Strzok, Page, Comey, Hillary.
Yeah, not hearings.
Okay.
Not hearings that mean nothing.
Right. Then
bring up the charges.
You're not going to see anything.
Without a hearing. Without due process. Because due process at this point stinks.
No, they can bring the charges, take the evidence, call a grand jury, just like Mueller's doing. For God's sakes, you got enough evidence against Hillary to form a grand jury.
More than enough.
I mean, form the grand jury. Let's go. Let's do this.
And I'm also hearing that there's a top FBI attorney that's flipping against the DOJ and is cooperating with a grand jury that has apparently been summoned without much media reporting. I mean, they're not talking about it. But Comey's going down.
Yeah, supposedly it was, I know what you're talking about, and he worked with the Obama administration.
Brady, something like that. I can't remember his name.
The Obama administration.
Yeah, he'll be dead.
I know what you... Oh, he could be.
Sorry.
Hanged from a doorknob.
No, he'll be shot in broad daylight.
Donald Trump said, tweeted, so terrible and nothing is being done at DOJ or FBI, but the world is watching and they get it completely. He was in referencing to the Fox News report about the text. You know, it's amazing that these text messages came out again, slowly leaking out, and the only one of the big news organizations covering it are Fox. I mean, for God's sake, CNN, for God's sakes, MSNBC, it does exist. You have to at least say this came out today, right? Mm. You would think so. Yeah. You would think Rachel Maddow would say, you know, not for nothing, I feel a certain way about this, but this is what dropped today. But they don't.
No.
You know, they don't.
And they're not going to.
It's the propaganda of silence so that the only people talking about it are conservatives, and it makes us look like we're crazy.
All this hurricane has done for them has been able to shut them up long enough for them to catch their breath.
That's true. Maybe they have the hurricane machine. Maybe it's the MSM that has the hurricane machine. So when stuff like this comes out that's beneficial towards Trump, boom, hurricane. You know? You're right. They did that. No, you're exactly right. Because when I put on Fox... the other night, which was Thursday night, they were covering news stories. And I think they actually were covering this story. And when I put on CNN or MSNBC, it was hurricane.
Oh, all about the hurricane.
All hurricane. Oh, yeah.
Which was Trump's fault.
Right.
Which was Trump's fault, anyway. So, yeah.
But, you know, at least get into it. But, you know, in a new letter to the Deputy Attorney General Rosenstein, Mark Meadows raised grave concerns about an apparent systemic culture of media leaking among high-level FBI and Justice Department officials to release information damaging to Trump. He cited the two text exchanges in April 2017 between now-fired FBI agent Strzok and FBI attorney Page, in which the two discussed the Bureau's media leak strategy. So that's where it all came about from. But, you know, it's fine to get these releases on all these texts, but eventually... you got to charge these two for collusion. I mean, you have to.
Obstruction of justice.
There's
a lot here. They ought to be doing something. Listen, if Mueller can get indictments against people for things that happened 10 years ago that had nothing to do with Russian collusion or the campaign, I certainly hope that they have enough evidence to bring Strzok and Page to justice.
This is pure proof that the media and the FBI and the DOJ are colluding with each other to take down the president.
And they're only the tip of the spear. The one wielding the spear is Obama. So it goes all the way to the top.
Yeah.
You're absolutely right about that. Listen, we're going to come back. We've got a great show today. I'll tell you about the guests next. But in the second topic, we're going to be talking about Maxine Waters threatening Trump supporters all the time. And this woman's still out there babbling on and on. Come on back to Freedom on Deck. Welcome back to Freedom on Deck, 94.9 News Now and Stimulating Talk. Listen, make sure you go to freedomondeck.com. freedomondeck.com. You can go like our Facebook, follow us on Twitter, check out our BitChute channel, check out our YouTube channel, and there in those links you can get our midweek podcast, which we were absent this week. It got a little hectic, but we usually always put one out, and all of our archives as well. We really urge you to do that. And just so you guys know, this week we have a great lineup for guests. We have Brian Malloney coming on next. He's from MediaEqualizer.com. And we also have, at the top of the 4 o'clock hour, we have Jim Schreiner, author of Jesus Christ Enough Already. And I will tell you, Jesus Christ Enough Already, that's a perfect transition to what we're talking about next. Because Mad Maxine recently joked about her now infamous comments to her supporters earlier this year, urging them to harass Trump supporters. You guys remember that. Show up at the diners, at the gas stations, wherever. Tell them they're not allowed. Tell them they're not wanted. Yep. Over the weekend, she joked that she threatens Trump constituents and supporters all the time, but wasn't doing it at that time. I said, if you see them anywhere and you see them in a restaurant, you can hear the people, oh yeah, that's right. At this Democrat, basically fanfare for Maxine, if you see them anywhere, you see them at a restaurant, if you see them in a department store, even at a gasoline station, just tell them you are not welcome here or anywhere, she said, recapping the controversial remarks. And of course, the lying president said that I had threatened all of his constituents. I did not threaten his constituents and supporters. I do that all the time, but I didn't do that time, she quiped to laughs from the crowd at the Stonewall Young Democratic Club Awards event. Okay, that was it. I was trying to think of that. So
and she did do
I
it stumbled that time. And she did do it that time.
Of course she did. And here's the thing. This woman goes out, makes these comments, and look what ensues. It seems like every time this woman opens her mouth joking about attacking Trump supporters, something happens to somebody on the right. There was a situation where a GOP candidate in San Francisco, the day after she made these remarks, was almost stabbed by some left lunatic with a switchblade in San Francisco, and it just boggles my mind.
I can't think of her name off the top of my head. She is a senator from Maine. Frey? Or something like that. Anyway, she was just threatened by a pro-abortion nut job. One of her administration women that works for her was threatened to be raped because she may vote for Kavanaugh. Do you see how this is the craziness? Mm-hmm. It's like, here's the left. They're all for abortion. They're all for women's rights, and they're all for, you know, all this equality and nonsense, but yet resort to threats of raping people's workers so that they can push their agenda or, you know, play fear tactics to make them vote a certain way.
It reminds me of Peter. Mm-hmm. It reminds me of Peter Fonda's threat.
Yeah,
remember that?
Yep.
Put him in a cage with pedophiles.
Yeah. Peter Fonda about Trump's son.
But this raises the question for me: is why does the left stream media and Maxine Waterlogged try to gin up the violence? Doesn't it? Wouldn't that hurt them in their elections? And then it occurred to me. I remember Project Veritas, where they caught the DNC operatives admitting that they were trying to provoke Trump supporters into committing violence so that they can be accused. And I think that's the bottom line. I think they're trying to gin up violence to get a reaction from us so that they can make us the story.
Well, when they get the ultimate reaction, they better watch out because it's going to be a war machine coming at them. But the issue is, I think you're exactly right, but I think it's more about them wanting to cause chaos. They really do want that. They want fighting in the streets. They want men on women, women on men, men on men, just from each side
women
of the aisle.
Women on women?
Going, yeah. going after each other in a way where it's like, if you get so incensed, they'll say, look who's the president.
Yeah, look.
Right?
Look,
that's going to be what it is.
Look who the problem is.
Yeah, they're going to make us the bad guy.
Look who the problem is.
Right.
When we know 8 years under Barack Obama divided everybody completely in this country.
Well, listen. I don't think Americans are as fooled as they think they are. You have hashtag walk away movement. They're actually going to be down in D.C. Coming up very shortly. I think next week, I believe.
It'll get no coverage.
So it won't get any coverage, but what is the bigger story, whether or not it gets coverage or not? What the left should be worried about is if, you know, 100,000 people, 200,000 people, 300,000 people show up there to say, hey, I am walking away from you.
Right.
That should worry them. That's enough people that you would think that they would be worried to say, hey, we better start reining in this nonsense, this rhetoric, this crazy talk, and start appealing to our better side.
Waters also said, I do not advocate violence. I do not believe you should hit, kick, or shoot. She said it was important to tell people the difference between violence and incivility and protesting. Well, the problem is, Maxine, your words don't match your message. When you're covering up for yourself, you're going against what you originally said. You just said, I normally say that we should go out and harass and attack Trump supporters. But then after that, you're saying, I don't want you hitting, kicking, or shooting them. Well, what do you want them doing?
Well, you know, she's got to cover herself because there are laws against...
she should be arrested.
Against inciting violence and inciting...
Yelling fire in a crowded building.
Right. That's what I'm saying. So she's got to be careful because if they could link it to her rhetoric and her inciting violence, she could be on the chopping block.
Well, I think that rhetoric's already been caused by others. Look at Bernie Sanders' CV. Who this scumbag that tried to did shoot Steve Scalise was working with the Sanders headquarters in D.C. And here he is shooting a GOP senator.
And did Maxine Waters say, don't hit, stab, or shoot? Or did she say, I didn't say?
That's what stab she and said. Shoot. I didn't
yeah,
say.
Yeah, so she's not really denouncing any violence. She's just covering her own tushy.
Exactly.
I like that word.
Which is a horrible thing to be covering. Can you imagine covering that, Tushy?
That's got to be a bit. That's got to be a big old sheet.
She needs to be arrested. She needs to be arrested. This is the second time now. How many times is this going to happen with this woman where the media looks the other way? And I'm sorry, Republicans should be shouting from the mountaintop.
I can't
about
believe
her.
These people keep getting reelected.
Well, it's California.
I understand that, but still.
She promises a lot
of
things.
You tell me everybody over in L.A. is crazy?
Well, there's a lot of people that want free things, and Maxine provides those things. I mean, listen, you can't have one flew over the cuckoo nest cannot be your leader. I'm sorry, and she seems to be. But anyway, listen, we're going to be coming back because we have a fantastic guest coming up here. And his name is Brian Malloney from Media Equalizer. And we're going to be talking about Colin Kaepernick. Nike making this the face of their franchise. Some things have gone in a good way. Some things have gone in a negative way. We're going to talk about it. Don't miss anything. This is Freedom on Deck. Welcome back to Freedom on Deck on 94.9 News Now and Stimulating Talk, WJJF on your FM dial. That's Connecticut, Long Island, and Rhode Island. You are rocking with the best, Chet Martin, Brian Breaux, and C.V. Burton. Our first guest to today's program is co-founder of the Media Equality Project and editor-in-chief of MediaEqualizer.com, the leading online watchdog for the intersection of media, technology, and government, Brian Malloney. Brian, welcome to Freedom on Deck.
Hey, thanks for having me on.
Now, before we get into everything else that we're going to talk about, which is Colin Kaepernick, because Nike has gone in a very strange way, and a lot of us conservatives are not in agreement with what they've done here, but explain to our listening audience exactly what you and others do at Media Equalizer, and also you are promoting a super PAC, Red Wave America, and tell us about that.
Yeah, so we started the Media Equality Project last year because we wanted to create a permanent fighting force for conservatives to fight back against, I mean, as you've seen, kind of the tyrannical nature of the left. And I mean, they're bullies. And so we have 111,000 members at our group called Stop the Scalpings on Facebook, Stop the Scalpings. And we're very active there. And then we branched out into something new. We just debuted a week ago, and it is the Red Wave America Super PAC. And we're going to be intervening in some of the big hot races nationally, some of the big Senate races and House races across the country as funds allow. But we're getting that going, and we have a website for that at RedWave.vote, RedWave.vote. And we're real active on Facebook there, too. So we're really super, super busy.
Well, we're super stoked to go check that out. Now, Brian, the face of Nike's Just Do It campaign, which is celebrating its 30-year anniversary, is also the face of Kneeling in America, former quarterback Colin Kaepernick. The media has celebrated this decision, Brian, but not all Americans are. Why do you think this decision was ultimately made by Nike?
Well, I think we have people nowadays who live in bubbles. They're not aware that a lot of people don't agree with these positions. In their little world, everybody thinks the way they do. You know, if you're sitting out there in coastal Oregon on the left coast, you know, as far as you're concerned, everybody that you know is also on the left. So why would anyone think any differently? And, you know, it's just like you hear people, well, how did Trump win? Everybody I know voted for Hillary. Well, that's because all the people you hang around with voted for Hillary. But it's because you don't know the vast majority of people that are out there in the heartland, different parts of the country who do not think, you know, they are not the coastal elites. They think their own way. And, I mean, it's amazing. So I think it's a classic case of being caught up in left-wing echo chamber and make a really, really dumb decision as a result.
It's funny you say that, Brian, because, of course, living on Long Island, I have liberal friends, not extreme leftist Antifa live-in-your-basement liberals, but I have liberal friends, and I had the same reaction when I threw my support behind Trump. He's got no chance. You know, Hillary's got the message that we, the American people, need to get behind. And they just didn't understand that the American people didn't want that.
No, and I don't think Hillary had much of a message at all in that campaign. I think it was, you know, it's my turn to be president. Hurry up and get this election over with so I can take over the world. And I think that was a losing strategy because people said, look, there's no reason to hand you the presidency. And, you know, had she actually been elected, it would have been disastrous. The funny thing is, I'm surprised how many conservatives I've run across that live on Long Island. You've got more around you than you'd know.
It's more Long Island. If Long Island was its own state, it would have went to Trump. We talk about it
all the time.
We talk about it all the time. But going back to Kaepernick, and I think that what you just were talking about ties in well with it, but with some of the consumers deciding to burn their Nike paraphernalia, sales have been on an immediate drop, but Nike stocks have jumped. Now, what do you make out of this?
Well, we're in a mega, mega stock market bubble anyway. So this is really, you know, there's a disconnect between sales and stock prices right now anyway. So I don't know if we should be worrying too much about the stock price. And we also don't really know how the sales are going to go for a few months. You have to see whether this really lingers or not, whether it really impacts sales. One problem nowadays, and this kind of helps Nike in a way, is that, you know, people have the attention span of a gnat, and things are forgotten fast. I mean, you might recall that just 2 or 3 weeks ago, we were all consumed by the media dragging out the funeral of John McCain over across an entire week.
Mm-hmm.
And that's already been forgotten, and people are already like, oh, yeah, that's right. You know, I mean, so we're living in times now where things move fast. And so whether this actually hurts them, I don't think it helps them, but whether it hurts them depends on the memory of consumers and how angry they are. And I just don't think we know yet.
You know, Brian, the media continues to downplay the fact that Mr. Kaepernick wore socks depicting cops as pigs and runs around with people in the likes of Linda Sarsour of CARE. His character should be part of the equation, right, Brian?
It absolutely should be. I mean, there's no question. I mean, from his perspective, he's trying to cash in on being, you know, an iconic symbol of the far left or whatever. And that seems to be working for him now. You know, if you're not good enough to play football, he seems not to be, then you go this route. So I think it, for him, from his standpoint, it's about making money. And I think that's the case for a lot of these lunatics on the left who are cashing in on whatever the flavor of the month is. And that's what it is. I think it's pretty clear.
And that's capitalism, isn't it, Brian?
Well, it really is. I mean, they're out there espousing socialism, and then they're wearing, you know, designer clothing and et cetera. So, I mean, that's what's going on now.
What about the irony? And we have Brian Malloney from MediaEqualizer.com on with us. Brian, what about the irony that Nike has sweatshops in Vietnam that have women and young children working for 23 cents to the hour to make these Nikes, and Colin Kaepernick is supposed to be the champion for folks that are the downtrodden, the ones that are being put down in the United States of America? What do you think of that?
Well, I think that's just the latest thing for the left to overlook. I mean, where they might have been concerned about sweatshops in the past, now they're not all as forgiven because of this move by Nike. So it really is about style over substance for the left. They don't really care about human rights. They don't really care about suffering overseas, except when it serves their agenda. And right now it's not. So suddenly all that's forgotten. So, you know, they are hypocrites. And I mean, and they always will be. I mean, I've been tracking these people for a really long time, and they never cease to amaze me.
Brian, you're behind Media Equalizer. What is your advice for conservatives to get around the, you know, Google and the social media monopolies who are trying to control the messaging?
Well, I'm just hoping that young people, and I think there are more conservative young people than are known, because, you know, from what we're hearing, you know, all the millennials are socialists, and I don't think that's true. But I think it's going to take younger people getting together and not only creating the alternatives to these monsters, but finding some kind of way to bypass all of it before it's too late. Because when I look at these tech giants right now, it's so scary what's going on. I mean, they're essentially marginalizing conservatives. They're trying to criminalize conservatives, wipe conservatives off the face of the earth to where you don't exist. You know, your website isn't searchable on Google. You can't collect funds on PayPal. You know, maybe you can't even have a web registration on GoDaddy. You know, the ways that they are systematically eliminating conservatives, Facebook, Twitter, you name it. Amazon has emerged as one of the most, you know, extreme far left companies out there. So we've got a real problem with Silicon Valley. And I'm just hoping that enough people rise up, especially younger people who might have some answers and some solutions, and do something about it before it's too late.
I don't know if you saw, Brian, but Google went after Gab AI, which is a counter media outlet where, so a counter social media outlet for conservatives, and Google said they were promoting hate speech. So now they've taken them down, right? And they're also not able to get a an app. So they can't get an app. Yeah. So when you don't have the ability to promote an app, or you don't have the ability to reach as many people that Google will allow you to meet, you're never really going to take off, are you?
Well, that's just it. So we have now really put all control over political thought into the hands of just a few tech companies. And one thing we need to do right now is make sure that Trump stays focused. And he started to go after them, but he gets distracted very easily. We need to keep him focused on doing what he can to break up these monopolies, because that isn't capitalism either. You know, Amazon, Google, that's not capitalism. That's just the railroad robber barons of the 21st century. It truly is. And we've got to do something about it. So, you know, it is really almost too late right now. It really is.
You know, Brian, I remember that not too long ago, they were all, you know, up in arms about net neutrality and all this other stuff, and about leaving the internet as a independent entity, that anybody that wanted to have a website or to have their social platform or whatever could go out and do so. How is it that Google is able to control every app that's on your phone? They're able to control, you know, every search that you make, that if Gab is a legitimate website, that they can actually stop people from looking that up.
Well, and I think that's what, I think we need to have more and more conservatives understand just what's going on, because I think there is a gap in terms of the tech sophistication on our side, where we have a lot of older people in our camp who aren't as tech savvy, whereas on the pro-censorship side, you know, you have a lot of younger people who are just seem thrilled with political correctness. They seem thrilled with just marginalizing people with other viewpoints than themselves, kind of just a lot of budding tyrants out there. So I think that's, we have to raise awareness real fast over exactly the scenario that you described, because I think a lot of people don't even understand it.
Brian, going back to Nike with their face Kaepernick now, and you also have Levi that took an anti-gun stance. Starbucks has gone pro illegal immigration. What would you suggest to the American consumer in doing to fight back against these companies pushing their liberal ideology onto us?
Well, funny, because there have been some editorials and others, oh, you know, these boycotts are getting silly and we need to stop boycotting every time somebody. But the bottom line is, you always have a choice in where you shop and what you buy, and just exercising that by voting with your feet can do a lot of damage. I mean, if it turns out the next time, you know, you were thinking about buying Nike and you buy a different product, if enough people feel the same way, then they get hurt. So it's real simple. I mean, why spend money on companies that are actively promoting your own demise? And that's what they're doing. I mean, that's what this is about. The left isn't about simply forcing its ideas down our throats. It's about eliminating the rest of us from society. And that's what they've been pushing. And they're getting really, really good at it.
Now, before we let you go, and before I let you promote the site again, I have to ask you, Brian, you a football fan?
Well, sure. I mean, yeah.
Are you watching?
I haven't been watching too much this season, just a few minutes here and there. Not too much, no.
So, you see, all of us around the table are doing the same thing, and I'm hearing this again and again from conservatives, that most of them, if they do watch, they don't watch as much, and if they see the kneeling going on, they're turning it off. I think that's, you know, that's what the American consumer and conservative does. We turn it off and we pay them no attention.
Well, I think that's absolutely right. And, you know, the NFL was always something that we thought of as solidly pro-American. And I think this whole thing caught a lot of people off guard and disgusted people. Football fans are patriotic Americans by and large. And so this was a ridiculous, the NFL never should have allowed this to get so out of control. They really blew it.
I agree. We just had Brian Malloney on from MediaEqualizer.com. Brian, remind everybody where they can go and check out this great super PAC you have going on.
Sure. So our website is called RedWave.vote, and we're going to be intervening on behalf of conservative viewpoints, essentially, in some key races across the country. And we have a great new Facebook group. Just if you're on Facebook, just go at Red Wave America, and it'll take you right to us. At Red Wave America, and then join our group. It's been taking off like a rocket, really has.
Excellent, everybody. That was Brian Malloney. We thank him for coming on. Come on back, because there's a stockpile of bottled water that was found in Puerto Rico a year later. This is Trump's fault. Give me a break. Come back to Freedom on Deck. And welcome back to Freedom on Deck, 94.9 News Now and Stimulating Talk. Go to freedomondeck.com. Check out everything we have to offer. Hopefully you're enjoying the show. Thank you for being here on your Sunday afternoon and enjoying it with us. Hurricane Maria, you remember that storm, guys?
No.
You remember that one? The one Trump botched, supposedly.
Did Trump cause that one, too?
Yeah, he caused it, and then he was very nasty, never sent any supplies over there after causing that hurricane.
You know, I heard something like that.
He had the nerve to stop the trucks from going over there.
Yeah.
You know, so a CBS journalist reported that he was told by the Federal Emergency Management Agency on Wednesday that bottles were found on an emptied out airfield base over in Puerto Rico. And not only that, it's quite a stockpile of water bottles. We're talking about
millions and millions and millions and millions of gallons of water.
Right. So these pictures have gone viral and on social media. Now, for some reason, they were left where the water was able to break down.
You know what it was? Trump didn't send the water. And he also didn't send any truck drivers or people to get it around to the people.
Right.
When he didn't send it.
So this is the emptied airfield, basically runway. Look at that. That is a massive amount of bottled water.
It's millions and millions. I mean, if that's bottles of water, that's billions of bottles.
And it was sent there to evaporate in the sun. And you know what happens to bottled water when the sun hits it?
What?
It's garbage. If it sits in the sun, it's garbage.
Well, because
it's no longer in use.
Yeah.
All the, you know, the good environmentalist Democrats over there, including the mayor that criticized Trump from the get-go. Remember when she criticized him in front of the pallets of water?
Oh, yeah.
Remember that? That wonderful mayor, the one with the mental disorder?
First,
this happens?
So are we to conclude that they withheld the water to make Trump look bad?
Sure. And let me ask you a question.
Could be.
Is it not drinkable? I mean, it's in a bottle. I mean, it's sterilized water that's in a bottle. It's not drinkable.
Once the sun hits it, the plastic gets into the water.
So you're leaching the BP. It's not BPA free bottles.
Right,
So once the sun is beaming on it, especially in Puerto Rico,
why they said it broke down. Now you could take the water and filter it again and use it, but I mean, now you're
that's ridiculous.
Yeah, exactly.
That's ridiculous.
Why are you going to do that?
I mean, I guess if push came to shove and you were dying of thirst, I guess you'd probably drink that water and just deal with it.
So these bottles were discovered by, well, yeah, you're right about that, but the point is, anyway, these bottles were discovered by a photographer working for a Puerto Rican police agency, Abdiel Santana, who first noticed them about a year ago and saw the water again when he returned to the airport this week. And they have sat in Ciego, Puerto Rico, one of the areas hardest hit by the Hurricane Maria, ever since, he said in a Facebook post. Is there anyone who can explain this? He wrote. The discovery comes as an independent study by George Washington University recently found that the nearly 3,000 people died as a result of Hurricane Maria, a dramatic increase from the initial estimate of 64. That's the other thing. So Puerto Rico Governor Richard Rosello also updated the official death count of Hurricane Maria. It went from 64 to 3,000 people. Oh, yeah. Give me a break.
Well, listen, I think 64 people died as a result of the storm immediately after, within a few days. I think that the rest of those people and those, which, I mean, can you really say that it was because of that? I mean, I guess if the storm damaged the power grid and caused so much chaos on that island and so much destruction that there was no power for months, and people that were on life support machines and things like that, that maybe had generators but ran out of gas because you couldn't get any gas. You know, I guess the chain of events could spiral into having larger numbers of people that have died subsequently because of the storm, but not directly from the storm.
I think they were adding on people that died of old age, all sorts of things. They were just like, okay, you know, another 2,000 some odd hundred people died, and we're going to put that on the death toll. You don't go from 64 to 3,000. That's ridiculous.
Well, this is what I'm saying, is I think that they're adding on anybody that has died as a result of anything that has to do with the storm.
If they lived in the area that it happened and died.
I mean, it engulfed the entire island. I mean, you know, but let's put it in perspective. It engulfed the entire island. The entire island, within a couple of weeks, I mean, roads were starting to become, you know, traversable again. You could get past. There wasn't trees all over the place. Now, is it going to take years for Puerto Rico to recover from this? Yeah. But then, you know, not too long ago, think about this. It was July, I think, 18th, that you had one of the mayors of one of the cities down there that was arrested as part of a probe of corruption.
Yeah.
And they were, you know, and they were doing all types of things. You have the stupid mayor of San Juan, that loudmouth idiot. You know, she's running her mouth. Is she running her mouth now?
No, she's not. She's quiet now.
She's real quiet. Mm-hmm. You dummy.
Mm-hmm. But the infrastructure in Puerto Rico was clearly corroded because it's just another Democrat-ruled bankrupt community, and. Also, the suffering could have been diminished significantly if they would have just distributed the water that Trump sent them.
And that's on FEMA. Everybody always jumps on the president. And I'm not just talking about Trump. You guys, you have to know how FEMA is involved with all this.
Yeah.
They decide where it goes, how it's brought in, what the cost is. Not what the cost is, but you know what I mean. And right. You can't blame this on President Trump. They used it as a political football, as usual. If they're Democrats, they're going to point out the faults of the president, which there were none. Well, we can't get these supplies out to where we're supposed to get them. Well, no one can unless they drop them in by plane. And that's what you were talking about with the San Juan mayor, who you're absolutely right now. Through this whole story, after you said that, I looked through it. I don't see any quotes from her.
Oh, no.
Not one.
She's burying her head in the sand.
Absolutely. But Trump creates all this, right? I mean, the weather patterns, the destruction of these of any of these hurricanes onto the United States of America and some of our provinces are because of President Trump.
Well, listen,
these people are sick.
I believe I saw a number. I believe it was 6,000 National Guard troops are on their way down to the Carolinas, if not already there. So, I mean, he's responding.
Oh, he absolutely is.
And he did then.
The media is responding the wrong way. But listen, we're going to come back. We have on Jim Schreiner, author of Jesus Christ, Enough Already. And this is an interesting book, folks. You're not going to want to miss this. Come back to Freedom on Deck on 94.9 News Now and Stimulating Talk. Welcome back to Freedom on Deck, 94.9 News Now, and Stimulating Talk. You're rocking with the best. Connecticut, Long Island, and Rhode Island. This is Chet Martin, Brian Bro, and C.V. Burton. Thank you for being here with us on your Sunday. It's very important to us that you are here listening. And our next guest has a book out that has caught the attention of devout Christians, agnostics, and those that are in between. Jim Schreiner is the author of the best-selling book, Jesus Christ, Enough Already. Jim, thanks for joining us for today's program, sir.
My pleasure. I'm very excited. Thank you for having me on.
So you started off as a devout Catholic, left Catholicism as a teenager at the encouragement of your own father, and became a born-again Christian. Now, your wife became ill during this chapter in your life. Tell our listeners how your wife's decline in health brought you to the point of questioning God and your faith, Jim?
Well, a couple times in my life, and that's how we actually came up with the title of the book, Jesus Christ and Upgrade. My wife had a very aggressive form of rheumatoid arthritis that ended up then turning into bone cancer. And the bone cancer literally, I mean, just destroyed her body. We fought it. My wife was a warrior, and we fought it the best we could. Well, we're standing in a hospital room. She, imagine now, she had her second leg amputated. So we've already lost one 2 years earlier. And now the bone infection disease is in her left leg, and we have to remove it. So she's just in recovery from having her second leg amputated when the surgeon came back in and said that the infection and the bone disease had now entered her spine and that they needed her to go back into surgery and try to start removing infected bone tissue from her spine. And now in the room was my mother-in-law, her priest, and four of the, which I guess you would call deacons from the church that we attended. And at that very moment, when the surgeon said that they needed to go in and remove more bone tissue, I literally screamed out loud, Jesus Christ, enough already. Yeah. You know, I mean, what more could happen to this woman? I mean, my wife was the most amazing woman you would ever know. And what more could happen? Well, just as the surgeon was leaving the room, the priest and these deacons all were laying their hands on my wife, and now they're praying out loud, God, saying, Lord, we want you to heal this woman, grow her new limbs, miraculously remove this disease. And I literally stopped them mid-prayer and said, now, you're trying to tell me, do you actually believe that God, on command, is going to instantaneously grow my wife new limbs and remove this bone disease? And without a hesitation, every one of them said absolutely with an astounding yes that they were doing miracles like this overseas for years. And I mean, it's as if a wave slapped me to the ground and somebody cracked me upside the head with a tubercore. And right then I said, all right, this is the biggest scam. You guys have never grown a person new limbs. Give me a break. Christ has never reached down out of the sky and grown a person a new limb instantaneously. It's never happened. So that was the first instance where I right then just drew a line and said, you know, because you got to remember, as in Catholicism all the way up through Christianity, I believed it. I believed it, and I had no reason to doubt it. You know, the pastors and all of the churches are saying, oh, yeah, they never had any pictures of it, but they always, oh, yeah, we're growing new limbs and new eyes and new ears and all this, and that was what. And so I believed it until that day. I could not believe it anymore. I do not believe that it. And I said right then, I said, not only is my wife not going to grow new limbs, it has never happened in the history of time. And I don't care what anyone tells you or the lies they tell you, no one instantaneously has grown a new ear or new eyes or new limbs. Never happened. And that was the first time I remember saying, Jesus Christ, enough already. And from that point, I started to do some research and homework and stuff. And one of the reasons that I think, I hope that I'm on your show is because we're right now, anyway, we have a crisis of faith in the Catholic Church. And that's what I've been addressing. I've been on a lot of radio broadcasts because in the book, I actually give a detailed account of how I came within minutes of being a victim, and one of my best friends ended up becoming one of the victims and was molested and has since committed suicide. And that I would need to talk about that because right now the Catholic Church is, you know, throwing their hands up. Oh, we need more prayer. We need this. No, they need shut down. And I know that's the big ask. And I said, I've been on the radio shows and said, you know, I know it's a big ask, but I think the entire thing, this needs shut down. It's the biggest blemish that has ever happened to humanity, and it's still going on. It's an epidemic. And I mean, I can't in my lifetime think of anything that has ever caused more destruction to humanity all the way back to the Holocaust. You know, I mean, we're talking about thousands and thousands. And I don't think the truth is ever going to come out to the accurate numbers. This is, I mean, I'm nearly 60 years old. I mean, this happened to me when I was 12, and it's been going on, and it's consistently going on. The Catholic Church is filled full of pedophiles. I talk about it in my book. I gave graphic details about exactly what's going on. It's the largest cover-up in history. I promise you, they all know about it. And what they're praying about is that it just goes away. Because if the truth comes out, or when the truth comes out, people are going to hear the numbers. They're staggering, and it is still going on. And everyone knew about it, all the way to the Pope. I promise you. And all they're doing is shuffling papers, moving priests here, archbishops here, covering it up. And it's just creating a bigger mess. I proposed two things. I said, one, I say we shut it down, but I think that's an impossible thing that's going to happen. So my job is to protect the children. That's all I care about, is protecting the children. So I said, we need to implement a guardian, that a priest can never be alone with anyone, especially a child, at any given moment. Even during confession, there must be a guardian.
Well, Jim,
that I agree with.
Jim, let me ask you a question. Yeah. We know what's going on in the Catholic Church. I mean, this isn't necessarily something that you feel that would be the norm in a Pentecostal church or a Methodist church or Presbyterian church?
You talking about what?
I mean, having these
the cover up with the molestation.
I'm talking about having a certain standards where elders of the church cannot be alone with children and minors by themselves.
I think I would put it across the board. The reason why I came up with this is it actually wasn't my idea. Believe it or not, I have a retired physician who is a very dear friend of mine. And he was a practicing MD, but he was also a psychiatrist, and he treated a lot of these boys that were molested, and he can't even talk about it. Him and I, he actually helped me write the book, but he can't even talk about it because some of the children that he treated went on to commit suicide. And when we talk about it, he just wells up and just bawls. And he said, it's just horrible. Well, what's interesting, he said to me, Jim, he said, as a doctor, you aren't even allowed to be alone with a patient. Think about that. When you go to your doctor, there's either a nurse in the room, or there's an advocate, or some other physician. Your doctor is not even allowed alone in the room. Now, I don't recall doctors being accused of molesting people, so I don't know why they did that. But nowadays, it's protecting the doctor, and it's also protecting the patient. So I'm saying that across the board, if you have enough, it's like a dash cam in a police car. If you're a good cop, which there are great cops out there, the dash cam is his best friend. But if you're a bad cop, that dash cam becomes your worst enemy, because it's going to catch you being corrupt. Well, if you got nothing to hide, in which there are some good priests, there are some good pastors, I'm sure. So if you got nothing to hide, you should be all for this. Say, look, let's put a dash cam in my office, or let's put a guardian in the room so that I am never alone with a child. Because think about that. It also protects the priest or the pastor, whoever, because now the child can't make false accusations. Say, oh my God, he touched me or something. And, you know, if you have a guardian there, and the guardian is there to protect the child and the priest. So
Jim,
again, it's
as an aside, I'm not clear about your message. Putting religion aside for a second, do you believe in God? Do you believe in miracles at all?
No, I believe in a creator. I guess the term is deist. I'm a deism. Einstein coined it best. I think that, as a matter of fact, I'm actually putting the pieces right now to produce my own television show, and the show is called Defending My Faith. I want to put together a television show. I came up with this. I think it's a brilliant idea. So far, the feedback's been fantastic. This is what I want to do. If you think about this, I have earbuds. Apple makes these earbuds, and they're a little container. And I go to these seminars, and I hold up this little box. I just imagine this little box. And I said, this is what the world is fighting over, literally killing themselves over. If this box is the first piece of life, I call it the first spark of life, the world, from the day of existence until the day it ends, we are constantly fighting over two questions. Where did that spark of life come from? And when it dies, where does it go? That's, in essence, that's what we're killing people about. Now, what's happening is, after my wife died, I don't know if you knew that or not, but in April 26th of this year, my wife literally died in my arms.
Yeah, we know. I know.
Well,
sorry about that.
And dude, I'm telling you, I'll probably never recover. Matter of fact, I've been on the phone with best friends all day today, just because I'm still not right. Yeah. She literally took her last breath in my arms and died, and I'm not recovered. Well, shortly after that, my front door almost to the house became a revolving door. Every priest or pastor within a 100-mile radius was coming paying their condolences. So it was interesting because, I mean, I had Seventh-day Adventists. I had Jews. I had you name it across the board. And so I came up with this. I said, you know, answer me this. Where did my wife go? Where did she go? And what was amazing is every single person had a different theory. They all, well, she's here, she's here, she's here. And you would be blown away at the answers I got. So I came up with this idea. I said, I want to do a television show, a documentary, and it could be a regular program because I want to have the top seven religious leaders on there from, let's go from, you know, Christianity, Catholicism, Islam, Buddha, Judaism, all the way across the board, and we'll have an atheist on the floor. And obviously the first two questions that I want to ask is, hey, where did we come from? Where did life come from? And where does it go when it dies? Because again, all we have is theory. That's all we have. But the challenge is most people, as my 50 years in the church, I can tell you most people don't actually know what they believe, let alone what somebody else believes. So I think the world is ready for this type of education. I want the world I want each of these religious denominations to defend their position. So I say, hey, where'd my wife go? And I want to give each one of them an opportunity to defend their position. And then obviously we'll get questions from audience or we'll get write-in questions. I want each person from each denomination to be able to defend their position. Because what I found is I had no choice. I was born into a Catholic family. My father then became a Southern Baptist Christian because he was saved through Charles Stanley. So then that was drilled into me. So now I'm a Catholic, then I'm a Christian. Now I'm an agnostic. Well, I believe something created that first spark of life. I don't know that I'll ever get to a point in my life where I don't believe something didn't create that spark of life. However, I'm telling you, I'm 100% convinced, 100%, being in the church as long as I have, there is no superior being judging you, reaching down out of the skies, answering prayers, performing miracles, blessing you financially because you sold more money. It does not happen. That just doesn't exist.
Well, Jim, we appreciate you coming by. We disagree with you. We are all Christians here, but we appreciate you coming by. Tell everybody where they can go and check your book out, please.
Best thing to do is you can either type, you know, Jesus Christ Enough Already. That's easy to remember. Or jimschreiner.com is my website. You can go there, get the book, follow me on Twitter, Instagram, YouTube. It's Jim Schreiner, like the Shriners Hospital. Or like I said, just type in Jesus Christ Enough Already. I appreciate you guys' time. Thanks for having me on.
Thank you, Jim. That was Jim Schreiner, the author of Jesus Christ Enough Already. Make sure you go check it out because it's important to have these conversations. We're going to be coming back to Freedom on Deck, and we're going to be talking about what the mainstream media is doing to our president. Come on back. Welcome back to 94.9 News Now and Stimulating Talk. This is Freedom on Deck. That last guest, I didn't like him. I'll tell you, I'm sorry, I didn't like
You're
him.
You're not supposed to say that.
I had to end it quick.
But buy his book.
But buy his book, right. I didn't like him. We were going to talk about a little bit of the media hiding all Trump's accomplishments, right? And which they are doing, and Trump has to keep talking about the economy, GDP, all these great things that Trump's accomplishing. But I did also want to talk about this because this is important, because it's so bizarre. We had a College of Southern Nevada sociology professor shooting himself while on campus last month in protest of President Trump. This is what police are saying. Mark Byrd, who's a professor at CSN in Las Vegas, was found suffering from a self-inflicted gunshot wound on the morning of August 28th. Richard Lake, a CSN spokesman, told Fox News He was treated for the injury to his arm and was arrested, Lake said. Byrd was charged with carrying a concealed weapon without permit, discharging the gun within a prohibited structure, and possessing a dangerous weapon on school property, the Las Vegas Review-Journal reported. In the report, police said Byrd told them he shot himself near a campus bathroom to protest Donald Trump. According to the Review-Journal, a $100 bill was also taped inside the bathroom with a note indicating it was for the janitor. You know, maybe he should have put down a sheet or something to stop all the blood shatter.
What a moron.
Or maybe he should have aimed higher.
Well, first, I would get some mental help. Then I would go and get a little bit better at shooting.
Yeah, I agree.
And aiming. Maybe next time you can hit your mark on your forehead.
I think his mark was never going to be on his forehead. He shot himself in the arm for a reason.
He's like,
this is my protest.
He's like those guys that were shooting themselves in combat. I wouldn't even say that, actually. I'd take that back. Because at least people in combat were up against it.
Right.
This guy is a moron.
This guy
can't. He wasn't up against anything.
Can't deal with President Trump. My God. It's the Trump derangement syndrome.
It's really being up against it.
That's true.
And the media, the left stream media, are very irresponsible because there are a lot of people on the edge of sanity that are just looking to get triggered in this way. And apparently there's a lot of really sick lefties in Las Vegas. You have that guy and the guy who shot up that concert.
In Vegas? Yeah. Well, listen, Las Vegas is full of sickos. What do you think?
And the media
in the middle of the desert full of liberals.
And the media is promoting this hatred. And there are unhinged people that are going to be triggered by it.
Well, I think that this guy is... well, first of all, he didn't get fired, right? He's keeping his job.
Nope, gets to keep his job. You know what's crazy about this? Is this is a school shooting,
mm-hmm.
right? This is a school shooting. Technically, it is.
It is.
And the media is silent on it.
Yeah.
Media's silent on it. Nope. No gun control here to be had.
No, because a good liberal had the gun.
Yeah.
It's like when a good liberal shoots a conservative.
No.
They don't say boo.
No, yeah. When we had a congressman being shot, they didn't say nothing about gun control then.
No, they didn't. But listen, we're going to be coming back. Last week, you know, it was our anniversary show to do with 9/11. Well, Joe Scarborough, MSLSD's wonderful host, him and his wonderful cohort, Mika, said Trump is worse for America than 9/11. Let's talk about this. Sickening. Absolutely sickening, Joe. No games played here. This is FOD, otherwise known as Freedom on Deck. Oh, yeah. That's right. Is it all right to call it FOD? Let people know.
All right, poppins.
Oh, I was popping on the mic?
Popping.
Oh, now you're popping. Stop with the P's. Stop it.
Yeah, there's a lot of popping going on right now.
So... Joe Scarborough, we're going to get into what Joe Scarborough said in a little bit on MSNBC with 9/11. And it was the wrong time, the wrong place. I know everybody has their own political leanings and they go off on a tangent sometimes. But one of the things that I found most offensive, gentlemen, was when President Trump went to Pennsylvania in Shanksville and he showed up. And what he did was when he came to the group of people awaiting him, he pumped his fists as to show support for the young man that survived cancer that he was greeting. And the media glossed over the fact that that's why he was pumping his fist. And we posted it on Freedom on Deck.
It's probably a white power thing.
Right. This kid, young man in his 20s that had no hair, that was receiving chemotherapy, was greeted by President Trump with a fist pump. And the media went after him and said, how dare the leader of the free world, which they don't like calling him anyway, fist pump during 9/11. Totally glossing over the fact of why he was doing it. Disgusting.
It's always about perspective with them. You know what I'm saying? You can't trust the media anymore. Bottom line. Haven't for a long, long time. You know, and it's just, it's another example of them being able to cherry pick, I mean, anything that he does, whether anything. It's a gesture, something he comments on or says, a bill that he signs or doesn't sign, a hurricane that he does or doesn't make. I mean, the list goes on.
With his hurricane machine.
Right. The list goes on and on and on. You know, they're never going to give him a break. They're never going to cut him any slack, and they're never going to give him the benefit of the doubt. Not like they did with Barry. Barry was a golden child.
The king.
A demigod.
You can't touch him.
King Hussein. You can't touch this.
You couldn't touch him.
Nope.
On the mainstream media.
He was their messiah.
And then, you know, what a lot of people don't understand, when September 11th happened, Donald Trump actually went in the next day, and you can find interviews, you can see it up on YouTube, where he paid for a lot of his workers, the construction companies that worked on his Trump towers or his Trump buildings, to come in and go through the rubble. And the way he reacted, he was there. He was there. Yeah. Give the man some credit, for God's sakes. You know, I mean, he was there for days. You can see images of him walking through the streets when the towers came down. They're up there, for God's sakes.
He was there 2 days. He had his people there 2 days after it happened.
Yeah, I know Hillary went in and made a nice op-ed picture. I know that. But Donald Trump paid for recovery at the 9/11 sites. Millions and millions of dollars. And he doesn't talk about it.
How many millions of dollars do you think Hillary paid out of her pocket?
Zero.
How many millions of dollars do you think the president at the time, George Bush, paid out of his pocket?
Zero.
I mean, he paid plenty out of our pocket.
Sure.
But out of his own pocket.
So then it gets into MSNBC host Joe Scarborough saying that President Donald Trump and his policies have hurt the United States far more than the September 11th, 2001 attacks did. That man is...
Should get punched in his mouth.
That man is a disgusting, disgraceful human being, in my opinion.
You know what the left-stream media remind me of? They remind me of the... Sadducees and Pharisees in the time of Christ. I'm not comparing Trump to Christ, don't get me wrong. But they always were trying to trip Jesus up, trying to catch him in a something he said, or twist something that he said so that they could entrap him and kill him. That's what these guys are like. It's like the same spirit. But Joe Scarborough, he used to be a Republican. He was a congressman, and he was, you know, kind of like a tough conservative type. And then he kind of like turned into this like pink sweater wearing wimp with glasses, and you know, and became all soft and smushy. Whatever happened? What goes through? How's a man change like that?
Well, don't forget, when he was running his campaign, there was a woman that worked for him that got murdered, that supposedly Joe Scarborough was having an affair with on his campaign.
Yeah. And died in his office.
Yeah, in his office in the late 90s. Well, look, Joe, whatever, anybody out there can Google Joe Scarborough. All you have to do is Google Joe Scarborough murder.
I wasn't laughing at that. I was laughing at Brian going,
I understand that. You can Google Joe Scarborough murder, and you can read the details about this woman that worked in his campaign that supposedly had extramarital affairs while Joe Scarborough was happily married at the time and ended up murdered.
He's a lot like Ted Kennedy, the swimmer.
And now look at him. He was married. He goes and actually starts an extramarital affair with Mika Brzezinski, whose father is a devout communist, and they have their own show together. Now, for Joe to make these claims about President Trump being far more dangerous to the United States than Islamic terrorists attacking the World Trade Centers on 9/11 should tell you all you need to know about Joe Scarborough and MSNBC.
All these media talking heads, they all try to outdo each other as to who could say the most outlandish anti-Trump thing. That takes the cake, though.
He also pointed to Trump's travel ban on immigration for Muslims into the country. The accumulation of that, the retweeting of neo-Nazi videos, this is Scarborough. Charlottesville, he added. I mean, I could go on and on. What he said about majority black countries that is tearing more at the fabric of America than the attacks on the Twin Towers did. We rebuilt from that. We became stronger because of that. But this seems to me far graver threat to the idea of America.
Yeah, because Donald Trump has murdered 3,000 plus people.
In Puerto Rico.
Apparently.
Well, you know, the idea of bringing in an ideology that doesn't mesh with ours, which is this Trump travel ban, to try to quell that, Joe Scarborough thinks that that is just absolutely anti-American. When did that ever become viewed from the left as anti-American, to not allow people to flood into this country and rip apart the fabric of our nation?
Well, look at Europe. That's all you need to know.
And he's not against immigration. He's against, he wants extreme vetting to make sure that the only people who come here actually like us. That's a novel idea.
Right. But like I said, look at Europe.
Yeah.
What's going on in Europe is going on in Europe because of what? Because of globalists, because of the EU, because of the Rothschilds and Soros and all these other ones that want that to happen because they want to force an agenda for a one world government. They want to create enough chaos in the world that they all come together as talking heads in this summit and say, we need a one world government. And all countries will fall under our rule. And the only way you do that is by tearing apart the United States. Because if the United States and other countries around the world, Hungary is one of them. Hungary is actually in the EU, and they're saying, nope, not happening. They're not coming here.
Yep. Socialism, Islam, and globalism make very disgusting bedfellows.
Well, did you see the Dalai Lama came out and said,
yep,
they send should them, go home. Send them home. They should them rebuild their countries.
He said they should make their own country.
Europeans should be able to fight their own battles and create their own jobs with their own people. And you folks go back and build up your country.
The Dalai Lama is on the Trump
defend yourselves.
Train. The Dalai Lama is on the Trump train.
Is he?
I don't know. It seems that way.
Sounds like he is, man. And he's a bright individual. But anyway, listen. Joe Scarborough also came back and he gave a weak apology. He said, on September 11th, I've read through the column again and think about whether I could have said the same thing in a way less offensive way of,
no.
For Trump supporters on the September 11th attack, he said. No, Joe, you screwed up, buddy. You're not my buddy anyway, but I mean, you're just a disgusting human being. Listen, we're going to come back. We've talked about this today. We talked about it last week. We talked about it the week before. It's Pope Francis attacking the great accuser for aligning the church with scandal. He called the folks calling him out and the church out Satan, basically, folks. Come on back to Freedom on Deck. Welcome back to Freedom on Deck, 94.9 News Now and Stimulating Talk. End of the show, and this topic is very important. We've actually had a guest on that brought it up before, but we're going to talk about it again here, folks. You know, religion and the religious aspect of America is a big part of our show. But during his mass visit on Tuesday morning, Pope Francis blamed the devil for the sexual abuse scandal that has shaken the Catholic Church to its core, but not in the way you would think. To the Pope's way of thinking, it is the efforts to expose the sinful cover-ups of abuse, clergymen, that are the work of Satan. Using the term great accuser, and that's important, during his homily at Casa Santa Marta on Tuesday morning, Pope Francis seemed to demonize those who question the actions of the leaders of the church, telling the assembled bishops that they seem to be under satanic attack in order to scandalize the people. So here we have the Pope coming out and saying that exposing the abuse and the crimes of the Catholics that are in the Vatican and throughout the churches in America, and these priests that have been relocated, by the way, to commit the same crimes unto children, that it is the accusers and the ones bringing this to the forefront that are the great Satan, not the criminals that are costing these children. Brian.
So what you're saying is that the whistleblower who broke this open, which it's always been there, but not in the way that we realized it was here in the United States. And the fact that this man is now Satan or acting on behalf of.
The actions are right. The work of Satan. Yes.
Right. So, no. When people do the right thing, that is the right side of moral, obligation, I would say.
Absolutely.
In this, especially in a church setting.
Right.
You know, you have to decide where you feel on different things in life. And you got to decide where your moral compass points to. You know, and if kids are being abused and you can turn a blind eye to that or partake in that or just simply ignore that, then, you know, that kind of says where your moral compass points to. And it doesn't point towards morality. Mm. You know, it's kind of disgusting that the Pope, who is supposed to be the leader of the Catholic Church, would allow himself to even utter those words.
It's funny how he's on the same side as the left media, left-stream media, when it comes to every other socialist issue. But when it comes to them pointing out the abuses of the Catholic Church, suddenly they become Satan.
Well, he comes from a socialist country.
Here's a good point that CV just brought up, and I don't know if he meant it this way. It's funny how this Pope is down with the New World Order cause,
yeah,
the globalist elitists, basically, and also the Democrats, and it seems like he's down with pedophilia in this statement. I'm sorry. Yeah. It seems like he's down that's with pedophilia.
Point. Yeah, that's a good point.
Why is that? Isn't that something that we've always talked about on this show?
Because he may
that
be
the
member.
Left is greatly involved with pedophilia.
Oh, sure. Yeah. Sex trafficking, all that stuff. Yep.
Funny how that works.
But somebody pointed out on another radio show, some caller called in, and said, what is the reason why they're drudging up all these allegations from the 70s, stuff we already knew about? They're drudging it up now all of a sudden, and they think it's – the caller said they think it's to hurt Kavanaugh's confirmation because he's such a devout Catholic.
Well, I mean, that could be true, but you know what – I mean, what were they talking? Were they talking about what's going on in the Catholic Church, or were they talking about like the Hollywood stuff? They were talking about
Okay, these allegations go back to the '70s. Like, we already knew about this.
Well, you know, here's the thing. I mean, most good Catholics aren't abusing children, right? I mean, this is people in the fabric of the church that have taken these jobs probably because they wanted to abuse children. So you can't take somebody's religion and twist it to a point where you say they're part of it as well. Because I'm sure if you asked Brett Kavanaugh what he thought about all of this,
oh, it'd be disgusting.
He would tell you that, you know, he's greatly disturbed by all of this. And he would basically, you know, I'm sure his statement would be in complete ridicule of what the Catholic Church has done here.
Yeah.
But getting back to the Pope, this is his statement. He said, in these times, it seems like the great accuser has been unchained and is attacking bishops, the pontiff said. True, we are all sinners, we bishops, he added. He tries to uncover the sins so they are visible in order to scandalize the people. The Pope continued, the great accuser, as he himself says to God in the first chapter of the book of Job, roams the earth looking for someone to accuse. A bishop's strength against the great accuser is prayer, that of Jesus and his own, and the humility of being chosen and remaining close to the people of God without seeking the life that removes this unaction. First of all, any of those verses have nothing to do with these evil acts that were portrayed upon these children. It's disgusting that we're even talking about what this man said. When are the Catholic followers going to demand that this Pope steps down? We've talked about this before. It has to happen. You can't have these kind of you can't have this type of thought in this church. And when are people going to finally? When are the followers of Catholicism going to get out in the streets and demand that this man step down?
This is kind of why I never got down with the Catholic Church. I mean, there's many reasons. You know, one that I don't agree with is praying to idols.
Yeah.
You know, Mary and all these different saints and stuff like that, and lighting candles and very ritualistic and things like that. And I don't get down with that because it's out of line with Scripture. But anyway.
I agree.
You know, one of the reasons that I really can't get down with it is because it's set up very much like government. Mm-hmm. You know, and, you know, there's a story in the Bible where Jesus goes into the marketplace, which they set up in the temple, and he, you know, in the courtyard, and smashes and flips tables, right?
Right.
Because they were defiling and making a mockery of the temple. So, like, you look at that and you look at the Catholic Church and how they have the church set up, and it's very much, I mean, he's elected to the position. I mean, think about that. You know what I mean? All these cardinals get together from all over the world to cast their ballot for this man who is, you know, I guess nominated to become Pope. And I don't know if there's multiple nominees or what, but it's like an election. You know, where do you see that in the church? You know what I mean? Like, you know, most churches across America and across the world, you know, church doesn't have a pastor. They find a pastor. They don't hold elections. You know, they kind of do a couple of interviews to make sure that the pastor kind of fits their belief, and then he's the pastor of the church.
Well, the Catholic church, you know,
the Catholic church is just weird.
It's so political.
And it's so money driven. Right. That's the other thing. You look at most churches in America, they're very humble buildings. They're wood and sticks and, you know, and asphalt shingles. Yeah. You go down to Hill Street over here in Southampton, New York, and look at the Catholic Church over there. It's clad in beautiful stone. I mean, it's all marble. All marble. The inside is just gorgeous. You know what that costs?
Yeah, I do.
You can feed a whole bunch of hungry people.
Yeah, it costs billions and billions of dollars. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Tens of billions.
Think about hundreds of billions of dollars. All the Roman Catholic churches.
Think about
churches.
The Vatican.
With the Great Wall around the Vatican.
Yeah.
And he says, don't build walls, build bridges.
But you have a wall.
Let them into the Vatican then.
But the thing is, of course it's going to be like a bad priest or whatever who's going to molest a child, but the cover-up, the systemic, I know socialists love that word, cover-up of the from the church of these allegations, it's the cover-up that's even the most egregious thing about it.
It is, and this guy covered it up for years before he became the Pope. Isn't that the issue here?
Yeah.
With this guy, Pope Francis? Mm-hmm. I mean, he is part of the issue. Now, it wouldn't shock me, and whether Catholic listeners of ours like it or not, it wouldn't shock me if this guy was a pedophile.
No.
Not at all.
Nope.
Not at all. Because when you look at what's going on with religion in America today, we have to protect our innocent. And if we're not doing that, Brian, what are we really doing?
We are failing.
Exactly.
We are failing. If we can't protect kids, then we are failing.
Yeah, Brian was talking about the Great Whore of Babylon, the Book of Revelations, and he was suggesting that possibly the Catholic Church is that Great Whore. But it also says in the Book of Revelations, come out of her, my people, so you're not a participant of her sins, and that you don't participate in her punishments.
Absolutely. It's well said, man. It's a good way to end it. But listen, we're going to be coming back next week, and we have some really wonderful guests up for you. We have Elena Marie Lopez. She's former journalist, citizen lobbyist, and advocate. And we also have Dan Perkins. He's political contributor to The Daily Caller, The Hill, Life Set, Newsmax. You know where to come. Sundays, 3 to 5. Same Freedom time, same Freedom station. Freedom on deck. Good day.